This is the design for the world's first modern floating city. It claims to be resilient to hurricanes and sea level rise, housing a sustainable and self-sufficient population.
A city that is the most resilient city you can imagine, but at the same time, the most enjoyable city that you can imagine.
A prototype is slated to be built in Busan, South Korea, under the watchful eye of the United Nations.
By 2025, nearly 6 billion people will live within 200 kilometers of coastline.
So UN Habitat is researching innovative ways to protect both lives and livelihoods from sea level rise.
Last year, flooding cost the global economy more than $82 billion.
What's happening now doesn't follow historical trends.
So a new industry of floating infrastructure is emerging, drawing inspiration from all over the globe.
Every inch of the moon has been photographed, cartographed. A fraction of the bottom of the ocean has been discovered.
But this kind of innovation is not cheap, with a price tag of $150 to $200 million per platform. Retrofitting homes so they can float on occasion might be a more financially attractive option.
I call them amphibious houses because most of the time they actually live on the land. When the flood comes, though, then they become sea creatures.
So is floating a good climate mitigation strategy to rising seas, or will our coastal communities be washed away?
We are literally like what Tesla would have been in 2005. That's how early we are in this novel emerging industry for floating infrastructure.
Oceanic City, designed by architecture firm Big, is the first prototype for the modern floating city.
So the idea of floating cities is to see if you can actually create a well-functioning, lively urban habitat that is powered by renewable energy that uses the available resources such as wind and water to sustain and feed and nourish the population and to make it a desirable and enjoyable way to live your life in the future.
The design is modular, meaning it can easily be scaled up or scaled down. The City of Busan's project will start with a lodging platform, a living platform, and a research platform.
The floating city will consist of multiple islands, so to say, but one island is 1.6 hectares, which is about 4 acres, and fits around 3,000 people.
It's going to be like an extension of the existing port areas. It's functioning in concert with the existing city as an alternative to create like neighborhoods that are floating.
Engel said his team wants to create a way for the UN projected 10 billion people that will inhabit the Earth by 2050 to have a lower energy bill, but the quality of life enjoyed by people in Denmark.
For a long time, we've been working on an idea we called hedonistic sustainability, that the sustainable city is not only better for the environment, it's also much more enjoyable for the people that live in it.
We are working, UN Habitat are working together with the world leading architects and innovators to pilot the floating city structure. And Busan itself presented a perfect partner in these areas because of its long standing role as a port a city. And also a strong industry and academia in the field of shipping and other ocean-related matters. And one area is that the commitment. We need the commitment from the leaders.
The physical location of Busan also made it a good testing ground. The calm waters of the bay will protect the floating islands from big waves and currents.
Right now, our primary focus is to go in sheltered harbor or river deltas or areas where we can just organically grow from the urban fabric onto the water.
But of course, it will be able to adapt to rising sea level in ways traditional land cannot.
The three key features of our solutions is that we are able to adapt to rising sea levels. So either by having retractable sea cables or having these dolphin moorings that can go up and down with the sea level. As this is a giant-sized platform, each individual platform, you have to understand how big it is. It's like the size of a football field. And the stability that is inherent with the inertia of the structure protects us against 100-year events.
100-year events are a benchmark that experts use to define how likely a natural disaster is to occur. Here, Hoffman means that the design can withstand events that are only likely to happen once in 100 years. Unfortunately, the summer of 2022 has seen multiple thousand-year events.
Life on the platforms is designed to be sustainable and self-sufficient, recycling water, growing food, and generating power via solar infrastructure.
Mostly a pescatarian, vegetarian diet, because dairy farming requires a lot of land, so you might have to make a few lifestyle choices to choose to live in a floating city.
The architects and designers also want to ensure equity in oceanic city.
We don't want to have that, oh, the floating city for the have, but not for the have not. This is the duty of UN Habitat to make sure floating cities program meet the needs and the criteria of inclusivity, resilience, and sustainability. That is our duty.
Oceanics' infrastructure can be built on any body of water, even America's Great Lakes.
As long as you're in the harbor, this is governed by the local government. So there's rivers, you know, lakes, open ocean is different. We're not planning to be in open international waters.
If Oceanic City thinks of itself as the Tesla to floating infrastructure, then there must be a hybrid model.
Retrofitting our current cities might be a more affordable solution to the 680 million people living in low-lying coastal zones across the globe. In the U.S., 29% of the population lives in coastal communities.
I used to live in Louisiana, and while I was there, Hurricane Katrina happened. I saw that the flood was the big issue, and I got angrier and angrier and angrier about how the people who were flooded out were being treated and the solutions that were being forced down their throats that they didn't want. I came up with the idea of trying to see if it was possible to make the houses float.
Drawing on inspiration from the Netherlands, Old River Landing in Louisiana, and other places, the Buoyant Foundation Project helps make homes amphibious.
It's not a floating foundation. It's an amphibious foundation because most of the time they actually live on the land, like an ordinary house sitting on their original foundation.
That strategy works well on houses without basements, like shotgun homes in Louisiana.
First, what we do is jack the house up a little bit and then put a new steel frame underneath the house in order to tie the house, the existing house, below the floor level to the elements that we're adding. And we're just adding two basic elements, the frame plus two. And those two things are something to create buoyancy, to lift the house and hold it above the water floating on the surface. And the other is to prevent lateral movement, to prevent displacement so that the house can only go straight up and down and it can't float away. And then we have to tie all of that back to the house. But we do all of this below the first floor level so that the rest of the house is left completely untouched.
The houses can stay afloat until the water recedes. It's a much more affordable retrofit than building a brand new city block.
Which approach is better? That depends on whether you're trying to make money or not. And you don't make money retrofitting houses for poor people. But retrofits in general are not a good way to make money because each one is individual and has to be custom designed. That's very expensive.
The floating city, by contrast, can have commercial purposes outside of escaping sea level rise.
It's a typical opco-propco model, you know, where you have a property owner and an operator, maybe a hotel operator that operates the property that is owned by some other entity, and there will be a rent charged, you know, either for an apartment or for a room or for an office space or for a store, and that will be in a financial model recovering the investment cost over the lifespan of the structure. There is likely going to be an offset, you know, both from a tax perspective as well as from a carbon credit perspective, which will subsidize this development. And it is also not just for housing or for real estate. It could even be for floating wind turbines or floating solar panels, you know, or even water treatment plants or data centers.
The cost per square foot for Oceanics is about $500 to $700, although it is an entirely different approach than retrofitting a home to be amphibious.
If people want to try to do it themselves, as they do in Old River Landing, then I would imagine the cost would be between $10 and $15 a square foot. If they have a contractor do it, it would be probably more like $20 or $30 a square foot. But I should say, we are not allowed to do it in the United States as a new build. Now, we can do retrofits. FEMA allows retrofits.
English says that making houses amphibious is better than elevating them onto stilts. It preserves the accessibility of the house and helps maintain the front porch culture of the community. But that might not be enough of a reason for the U.S. government to encourage it.
FEMA has a very good reason for wanting to discourage the development of amphibious housing in general, because a community, a municipality that has a lot of wetlands, is always under pressure from developers to develop the wetlands, and the community would like that too if they could, because then it becomes taxable property. But the wetlands play a very, very important role in the ecosystem. So I absolutely do not promote moving into wetlands. What I want to do is preserve culture where it already exists.
Either way, both approaches acknowledge something that coastal communities have known for a while. You can't stop the rising sea. The summer of 2022 was already dubbed the summer of floods, and the 2022 hurricane season is already predicted to be above normal. Retrofitting homes to avoid sea level rise might allow people more time to decide what they want to do to protect themselves from climate change.
As a temporary solution, it prevents someone's house and possessions and all of their belongings being traumatically wiped out all at once. It gives people a lot more choice. The community can decide to move as a unit if they wish, or they can all decide to try to resettle in the same place. But people have a choice as opposed to being wiped out in a terribly traumatic way that will haunt them for the rest of their lives.
Floating cities could help residents adapt in place and extend the life of a country.
Island nations where you will actually need to move the urban population onto a floating city because they are somehow destined to go underwater.
All of the parties recognize that climate adaptation is an evolving but necessary industry.
There will also be a tremendous amount of competition with other players entering the market, which will be super healthy. You're like in the cell phone era. Remember when you had the big heavy things you had to carry, and now everybody in Africa has a cell phone and they never needed the grid. I think the same will go in our era for floating infrastructure.
The hope is one of these ideas might be able to mitigate some of the worst impacts of our new climate reality.
We have to look into the adaptation. Innovation. We really hope that it will be a successful project, and we would like to replicate it in other parts of the world. I'm not scared of failure, but I think we learn from there. So let's do it.